If there's a cross between a trailblazer and a troublemaker, it was likely Congressman John Lewis. Many refer to Lewis as the person who inspired the term good trouble. A proponent of nonviolent civil disobedience, Lewis spent his life agitating for social justice and paid a price for his courage. Even as a member of Congress, Lewis sometimes encouraged people to break laws if it meant affecting systemic change. One of his staffers, Andrew Iden, convinced Lewis to record his story in graphic novel form, and the result is an award-winning trilogy called March. Our special correspondent, Alexis Clark, explores March's account of Lewis's early troublemaking days in the civil rights movement.
It is frightening.
Right?
Capturing the hoods.
Yeah, in that light.
And the N-word, again.
Yeah, that was also something I really struggled with, and it's like...
uncomfortable.
Yeah, you talk to the congressman about it and he's like, you can't leave it out.
Though often described as a graphic novel, March is a memoir that tells the story of Congressman John Lewis's life, growing up in rural Alabama, to becoming one of the most influential leaders in the civil rights movement.
Give us a vote!
The idea of the comic book series came from Andrew Iden, who worked in Lewis's office.
I started working for Congressman Lewis in 2007. That was such a tough year for him. He endorsed Senator Clinton in October of 2007, and the backlash was profound. I mean, I'd never seen anything like it.
The backlash was profound because Lewis had endorsed Senator Hillary Clinton in the presidential primary before switching his backing to then-candidate Barack Obama. With Lewis facing a tough re-election race in his home district of Atlanta, Andrew worked closely with the congressman.
And that was really where I got to spend the most time with the congressman I had so far. That was the first time I heard about SNCC and the role that young people played, how they pushed the policy forward, how the sit-in movements led to the Freedom Rides, how the Freedom Rides made the March on Washington possible, that connective tissue of understanding that was really left out of schools for me.
But despite Lewis's long history of organizing and activism and leading the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, known as SNCC, his campaign was concerned that the younger generation wasn't that enthusiastic about him.
So much of the criticism of John Lewis at that time was, what have you done for me lately? What did you really do during the movement? This is something that I think is really important for people to understand, because they think of the sit-in movement as starting on February 1st, 1960, with the Greensboro Four. And as this like spontaneous movement. They did the test sit-ins in Nashville before they ever sat in Greensboro.
After Congressman Lewis won his re-election, his campaign staff took a pause.
Folks were starting to talk about what they were going to do after. And I said, I'm going to Dragon Con, which is like the big Atlanta comic book convention, cosplay convention, and everything. And so everybody on the campaign just started laughing at me. You know, it was sort of this like, oh yeah, the nerd. And then the congressman said, don't laugh. There was a comic book during the movement, and it was deeply influential. And it was like, you know, what is this comic book he's talking about? Martin Luther King and the Montgomery story is what he was talking about. And so I went home that night and I looked it up on the internet and I was amazed. And I just remember sitting there just saying, why isn't there a John Lewis comic book?
That's quite a departure. I mean, you've got a civil rights icon. What was his response?
He said, I thought that boy lost his mind.
But the congressman eventually agreed. And Andrew spent endless hours interviewing him.
First, we were trying to just teach his story. Then we realized we could actually inspire this generation to understand nonviolent civil disobedience. The congressman would always say, I think we're too quiet. He would say, I need you to speak up and speak out and make some noise.
Lewis became a part of the nonviolent movement when he was just 18 years old, shortly after meeting Martin Luther King Jr.
He would always say, Dr. King was my friend, my hero, my leader. And he was so loyal to him. But I think what John Lewis loved most about Dr. King was what a sense of humor he had. After a march or in the evenings, they would get together in the hotel room and they would preach each other's eulogy. And they would make fun of each other, like mercilessly, right?
The March series not only details the relationships John Lewis developed, but the books also show what Lewis and so many other activists endured, which at times was raw brutality. And illustrator Nate Powell captured it on the pages.
It was quite a journey. It was, you know, it was a good 4.5, 5 years at the drawing table.
Congressman Lewis and Andrew and I knew and understood and embraced that we weren't going to hold anything back. I don't see how we can send troops to Africa, and he can't send troops to Selma, Alabama.
What was it like illustrating the life of an icon like John Lewis?
there's a relationship, friendship, that really took off and blossomed. His public persona really was fundamentally who he was as a person.
How did you capture the hatred and the racism?
It was a balancing act throughout. A lot of it really has to do with framing it through the lens of the people who survived the violence and endured the violence, and at times flipping the camera on the page to force the reader into a position in which they were perpetrating the violence against some of these civil rights activists. And that level of discomfort was really important to identify and magnify at times.
You know, the congressman would always say, you have to dramatize the conflict. And so much about the movement was forcing that dramatization. And that meant drawing out incredible ugliness in people.
John Lewis saw that ugliness firsthand when he led the march across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama.
Selma wasn't supposed to happen. John Lewis went against his own organization. They didn't allow him to march as chairman of SNCC. He just acted. It was Andy Young who came and said that Dr. King wouldn't be at the march. And so John Lewis was like, all right, I'm gonna go.
Now these omitted details about the civil rights movement are being taught in schools across the country, thanks to March.
So there was all of a sudden people willing to ask, why do we need to know the history of the Voting Rights Act? You can read March in a day and have a solid understanding of the breadth and depth of the movement from 1960 to 1965, particularly from the young people's perspective.
In 2013, shortly before March was released in the Shelby County v. Holder case, the Supreme Court struck down a section of the 1965 Voting Rights Act, the very piece of legislation that Congressman John Lewis had worked so hard as a young activist to get passed.
What would you think John Lewis would say about the current state of the attempts to ban books right now and eliminate the teaching of civil rights history in classrooms?
Oh, I wish he was still here because he would be fighting that fight. He would say the same thing he said to us many times before, which is, I think we're being too quiet. That now's the time to speak up and speak out and fight back.
Thank you, Alexis. It's been almost 2 years since Congressman Lewis died. In an op-ed penned for publication upon his death, Lewis wrote the following. He said, "Democracy is not a state, it is an act, and each generation must do its part to help build what we call the beloved community, a nation and world society at peace with itself."